In a previous video, I talked about the Ender 3 V2. Creality had just announced it and released some specs, so I shared it with my audience, and I used a virtual image for the machine because I didn't have one, but apparently I did a good editing job because some people thought it was real. Well, now I have a real one, so let's take a look at it right here at Filament Friday. Filament Friday is brought to you by these Patreon supporters. The Ender 3 V2 is basically an upgrade to the Ender 3 Pro. Now this one's been modified by me quite a bit, but it still has the original flexible magnetic bed. This one sells for $269 on the Creality website, and they're sold out right now. This one sells for $239 on the Creality website. So it's a $30 difference from the manufacturer. So let's look at the features on this and how it differs for that $30. The first thing you get for the extra $30 is a glass bed. Instead of that magnetic bed, you get a glass bed with a textured surface, two clips, one in the front and one in the back. Hold it so you can pop those clips off, take the glass bed off. You can actually flip it over and have pure glass, not the textured glass. So you have a choice, but that's one thing you get is a glass bed. Another thing you get are belt tighteners, one on the X and one on the Y. The X one's got a little bit of an issue. I'll talk about that, but it comes included. They are plastic, not metal. I prefer metal, but belt tighteners are nice. Another thing you get is a knob for the extruder so you can turn it. This thing is really loose though. It spins it, but it's really loose. You can pull it right off. I don't know if that's any better than what you can 3D print, but that comes with it as well. Another difference is the cover over the hot end. The hot end itself is actually the same as the Ender 3, Ender 3 Pro, but the cover is bigger and it's plastic. The Ender 3, Ender 3 Pro has a metal cover here with two screws in the front, and you can get at the coupling without taking the cover off. This one, you have to take the cover off to get to the coupling. So if you want to pull the PTFE tube out or got a jam, you got to take this cover off. And the screws are in the back, not in the front. So it's a little bit more of a hassle than the fact that it's plastic. Another difference is the holes in the front are tighter. So it's harder to get filament into the fan, which is kind of a good thing. But it also makes it harder to see if the fan is spinning. So if your fan ever fails or stalls, you can't tell. I had to put my ear up to it to make sure it was spinning. And part of that is because this fan seems a lot quieter than the Ender 3 Pro or Ender 3. So I think that's an advantage. I haven't done any true measurements. I'm just going by my ear, but it definitely sounds quieter on this machine than the Ender 3 Pro. None of those are major differences. I would say spend $30, but here is where I think it is worth it. First of all, the power supply is no longer on the rail here. It's built into the base. The switch and the plug are in the back, and it is a Meanwell power supply, just like the Ender 3 Pro. So that's good, but I like that it's in the base, keeps fingers away from it, little fingers from it, for that power supply. Not that it wasn't safe, but I like it enclosed. But the biggie, 32-bit board. It's got a 32-bit electronics board and more memory. And because of that more memory, you have more functions in the menu. And the menu itself, the display, is a icon type display. You still have a knob to turn and click, but there's a lot more features. You can adjust your acceleration, your jerk. You can even set the retraction speed up to 50 millimeters per second instead of the default 25 and save it to EEPROM. All those are inside the display. And as far as the electronics board, 32-bit board, it also has a plug for a BL touch, so you can add that later, and also has a plug for a filament runout sensor. Now, there isn't a filament runout sensor bracket, and this plastic thing on the front does not have a bracket for a BL touch. So I could see that this is one of the first things the community is going to reprint and make one so you can easily put a bracket on it. But the capability appears to be in the hardware into the board. So updating the firmware to be auto level should be fairly easy. And that's another advantage of the 32-bit board. You don't have to plug in Arduino with a bootloader and all that. All you do is you put the new firmware on the SD card, and it is a micro SD right here in the front, just like the Pro. You flip the card over, but you put the firmware on here. It's a .bin file. You put it in, you start it up, it'll sense that and upload and update its own firmware. That's the advantage of 32-bit. So I think that's a huge step up for this machine. And it does have silent drivers. So I believe they're 2209s. They may be 2208s, but either way, it's quiet. This machine is definitely quieter than any other Ender 3 machine I have. Even with the Noctua fans I put on mine, this thing is quieter. I had it in my office printing, wasn't bad at all. In fact, the only real noise that's coming from it is from the Meanwell power supply. This fan up here is definitely quieter. So overall, that's it. Those are the big differences, but is it worth $30? Well, the fact that Creality charges $49.95 for their 8-bit silent board, that alone says it's worth it. $30, you get the 32-bit board, a better display, and then all the other little features that I mentioned, plus the glass bed. Oh, you even get a drawer. So there's definitely features in this, and for $30 more, I think it's worth it. Assembling it was very similar to any Ender 3. I used the procedure. I have a whole video on how to assemble an Ender 3, and it worked well here as well. The only issue I had was the X adjuster. The screw in the front goes in the same hole as the bracket screw in the back. They butt up against each other, so you can't get this thing tight. And then I had a problem running my bed level G-code. It just didn't read it right. It homed, but then it's supposed to go over the top of the screws. But listen to what it did here. It moved to the right. It made that grinding sound, and then it just went home. So it didn't read the G-code properly. I didn't print a ton. I had some problems getting it printing at first. Once I did, though, it printed equal to my Ender 3 or CR6. I tried different filaments. They printed really good. But getting the bed level without my G-code was a little bit tougher, but I got it done, and the first layer prints on this glass bed looked really nice. If you're just getting into 3D printing or looking for a second printer, this is what you're looking at. The CR6, I did a full video on this with all the features. You get a bigger build area, you get the built-in auto level, which works really well. You get a better extruder top, so you can do Ninja Flex. You get the filament runout sensor, you get dual lead screws in the back, you get a touch screen. And I'm told it's not shipping with 32-bit, although mine is 8-bit. And if it's 32-bit, then that's a heck of a machine, but you're talking at least $100 more than this guy. In fact, the retail is $429. I figure it'll probably be like $389, and maybe it'll go up with that 32-bit board. I don't know. But at least $100 more than this, is it worth it? If you really want auto level, you want a little bigger build area, you want some of these other features, then yeah. But for a good starter printer, I think this is excellent, and the 32-bit makes it easy to upload the firmware. And then the other features that it's got, I think it's worth the $269. If you're really on a tight budget, certainly the Ender 3, not the Ender 3 Pro, just the base Ender 3 is still a great machine. $219 at Creality, you can get it at various places for less than that. And it's still a great machine to start with, and then you can build it the way you want it. But I think this was a good in-between machine. And at that price, $269, I think this is a great starter printer. So that's it for this week. If you like what I'm doing here, check out some of the videos that are popping up. And if nothing else, click on that CHEP logo and subscribe. That way you don't miss an episode. I'll see you next time right here at Filament Friday.